who is the church? Why do we even care? In this autonomous land of individuality, freedom, and democracy, why do we care so much about the whole when we could be talking about the one? Well, as we learned indeed from that teaching of Scripture, who the church is, it is an outpost of heaven. It is a people of God. It is a church of Christ, the Savior. He is the head of the church. He is the firstborn from the dead, as we read in Colossians chapter 1. Last week, we took a look at 1 Chronicles 16. We talked about what motivates the church. What motivates the church? What's always motivated God's people? God's glory. And we talked about what is inherent to God and what is ascribed to God. What is inherent to him in his glory, and yet what is, by invitation, ascribed to him in glory, what is given to him in glory, and how we are identifying as a part of that. Friends, as I said to you last week, and as I've just been thinking on throughout the week, and I pray and don't stop thinking about it, it's just how the glory of God captures our attention, how it motivates our affections, how it redirects our passions. The glory of God is indeed a fuel for the motives of our lives. Well, this morning we are answering the question, what is the church's relationships to itself? How does the church not just view itself? What does it do with itself? Kind of a continuation of what I've touched on already this morning, but specifically answering the question in light of our mission statement. Next week we'll be talking and answering the question, what is its relationship to the world? How does the church view the world? How should the world view the church? Churches have been, in an attempt to be concise and succinct in their communication, have tried to emphasize these audiences that mission statements often reflect. These audiences of God, audiences of the church itself, and audiences of the world. Such expressions like upward, inward, and outward, exalt, equip, evangelize, declare, develop, deploy, you name it, pick your letters. There's an expression to go with it. I want to review with you the mission that I've laid out for you in these previous weeks. The mission of Castleview Baptist Church is to glorify God. That's our mission. Now the question is, how will we do that? For this morning, I propose to you by developing gospel-centered disciples. By developing gospel-centered, that's hyphenated, gospel-centered disciples. And as we'll talk about next week, and proclaiming the gospel of Christ to the world. Now you'll notice there that I'm being intentional, and as we've written this statement together as elders, intentional in using this word gospel twice. Once as a noun for what we're proclaiming to the world, that's often where it's expected in statement, but also as a modifier to describe us as disciples, that we're gospel-centered, that it gives shape and definition and meaning to our identity. That is that part that I want to address to you today. Now, before I go any further and explain that to you, there's something I want to encourage you with. Perhaps you don't know, others of you do know, some of you here because of it. Castleview Baptist Church, we're serious about getting the gospel out and serious about those who come within would understand our relationship to the gospel and how that has changed our life, and even as Christians today, is changing our lives. Well, what we have done in an attempt to communicate this, as we're always trying to be creative and as the Lord provides resources to do so, we wanted people to know in Indianapolis that we are people changed by Jesus. So what we did was we put a 60-second spot on the radio, 99.5 WZPL. Some of you know that. You're here because of that radio spot. A non-Christian radio station starting in March of this year, ending in a couple weeks coming up in May. Our spot airs 9 times a week with an audience of over 137,000 people. And our attempt in this spot was to just declare how we came to know Christ and how the gospel is a significant tying mark to that. I don't want you just to believe me. I want you to hear it for yourself. So I've asked them to cue that up and to play that you might be encouraged by that 60-second spot being broadcast over 100,000 people. That's the cue. I was supposed to do left hand, maybe. There's the left hand.
I became abusive with alcohol and almost died one night.
Let's start at the beginning.
I'm David, and I lived in a Christian home thinking that that alone made me right with God. But as I got older, I became abusive with alcohol and almost died one night as I wrecked my car while drinking and driving. God saved me that night, and afterward, a friend shared the true gospel with me. I now live in response to Jesus' payment for my wrongdoing.
I'm Stephanie, and I was raised in a very strict religious home, depending on do's and don'ts and my own efforts to be good enough. Years later, God brought me to a church that challenged me to dig into the Bible personally. His words showed me that through the grace of Jesus Christ, I can live a life pleasing to God.
I'm Eric Bancroft, senior pastor at Castleview Baptist Church. These testimonies are real examples of the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. To know more about Jesus Christ, please visit us on Sunday mornings at 10:30 at the corner of 86th Street and Hague Road, or visit us online at castleview.org.
That radio spot was intended to communicate what I hope you've already now heard yourself this morning, that our relationship with the Lord became reconciled to him because of his work on the cross in the form of his Son, the second member of the Trinity. That because of his life, his death, his resurrection, his ascension and intercession even now for us and our faith in him, that we've been forgiven of our sins. And maybe even this morning, some of you are here this morning because you've heard that radio announcement. As a church, we are committed to proclaiming the gospel to those who do not know the gospel so that they might hear what it means, good news. That they might believe its truth. That there is salvation, that there is rescue for me, somebody who needs to be saved, to be rescued, to be redeemed, broken, fallen, frail, shattered, to be put back together by faith in Christ. But that's a conversation that's simply an introduction to Christ. Not kind of a once, never to be seen or talked about again. For us as Christians, it's an ongoing conversation. Much like the conversation that you had with your wife or your husband as you found them at the end of a row in the middle of some location where you covenant together and you performed a wedding ceremony where you became identified as a married couple, where you covenanted together. And that marriage identity continues to this day. You introduce them accordingly. My husband, my wife. You don't say, well, that was once my husband. Well, did you guys divorce? No. What's the story? Well, we got married 25 years ago. Well, you're not still married now? Well, yeah, but you don't talk about that in past tense reality. It's just present tense scenario unfolding in conversation. Well, that's what it's like for us as Christians. We don't identify with the gospel in order to become a Christian, but then move away from it now that we're Christians. We've talked about this. It's worth repeating because it might be new for others of you who are newer to us in gathering and identity. The idea of coming to faith in Christ is to come to him, and not so that you might get out of hell free card, that you sort of put that in your inventory of life and then sort of put it away, and then later on as you work through life and you come to the end of your life, and God's like, whoa, 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 where do you think you're going? Trying to make your way into heaven. Hold on, I've got it in here somewhere. There's a get out of hell, get into heaven card. A boom, here's the gospel, Jesus. I can pass this quiz. I know who you are, I know who I am, and here's the exchange, and my faith is in you. And that's not at all what we see the scriptures teach. While it is true, salvation in Christ saves you from eternal damnation. While it is true you have an eternal rest in him, heaven is to be gained, suffering and pain are to be removed, all of that is true. What is not true is that the gospel is a once for all time conversation, never to be returned to again. But sadly, this has become all too common for many Christians to not think about the gospel since the days when they first heard and put their trust in it. They put it on the shelf and go on their newly principled life as Christians. And so from now on and forever until you die, all you need as Christians is just principles. Principles for marriage, principles for finances, principles for intimacy, principles for parenting, principles. You just principle, 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 principle. Principles for cooking, principles for eating, principles for driving. How do Christians drive? How do Christians vote? How do Christians eat? How do Christians exercise? Just give me more principles, what Christians do. This is misguided, though perhaps well-intended. C.S. Lewis helps us here when he writes, "We must be convinced that there are no such things as Christian principles. There is the person of Christ, who is the principle of everything. If we wish to be faithful to him, we cannot dream of reducing Christianity to just a certain number of principles." That's the weakness for every preacher, myself included, when preaching God's word to you. You understand the minute I sort of put out in front of you points of application, of which, just as a side note, in case you're wondering where those are often found, they're often not the end of the sermon, but they're peppered throughout the sermon, and they're not often put on the bottom shelf with, like, here's 3 points of application. Sometimes I do that. But I want you to listen carefully with me throughout. But the weakness that can happen sometimes in this sort of principalizing, reducing all of what's just been said in the glory of God, if you believe all of that, you'll do these two things. As if somehow to think all of that can be summarized in these 2 points. Friend, indeed we find in the gospel how that is not true, how it's not just about principles. It's about knowing, believing, following, becoming like, and proclaiming Christ. Some people have asked me, wouldn't it just be better to say Jesus-centered life? Jesus-centered life, gospel-centered life. Seems like you're sort of advocating gospel over Jesus, as if it's more about the gospel than Jesus. Well, friend, I don't mean to divide the two as if there's some sort of dichotomy there. Why do we say gospel-centered life? Why do we say gospel-centered disciples? The reason is because we mean to be specific about the person, Jesus, and the work of Jesus. The person and the work of Jesus, Christ, the Son of God, the Savior, for sinners. So now, that takes me to what I have for you this morning to frame this up from Scriptures. And we're going to go back into Philippians. So, back into Philippians, because we've gone through that, but I want to go back to that. For those of you who have not been with us, Philippians is a letter that Paul's written to a church in a city called Philippi. It's a 2,000-year-old letter, but inspired by God, given by God, true and relevant for us today, as if God is speaking in this room right now. As I read his word, that is God's word himself. As you're turning to Philippians, let me just remind you or tell you, we'd love to put a copy of the scriptures in your hand if you do not have a copy that is easy for you to read or a copy at all. As you make your way at your doors, to the right there at the Welcome Center, we have stacks of them. I just checked on them this past week, make sure they're there. Stacks of English Standard Version Bibles, just sort of literal but readable translations for you to help you understand the word. Always available for you. If you don't have a copy, you can look out with somebody else this morning. Philippians chapter 1. Now, just to kind of frame this up, Paul is talking about the gospel. He's thanking God for the response to the gospel, Philippians chapter 1. He's talking about his ministry of proclaiming the gospel, his defense of it, chapter 1, verse 7, he says, his defense and confirmation of the gospel. He's seeking to advance the gospel in verse 12. He is indeed in desiring to not worry about giving a defense for it in the sense that he wants to be able to proclaim it, verse 16. He comes to this now in chapter 1, verse 27. And in this section here, verses 27 through 30, I want us to look at 3 ways the gospel is the center of our Christian lives. But here again is the weakness to this very sermon outline itself. I by no means mean to say there are only 3 ways. I mean to say here are 3. Amongst countless others, let me give you 3 ways the gospel is the center of our Christian lives. First of all, the gospel compels personal holiness. The gospel compels personal holiness. Look at there in verse 27. Paul describing here their faith, their progress and joy in the faith, verse 25, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again. Now look at verse 27. Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit. The key here in the first part of the gospel compelling us to personal holiness is to identify that our life motivation towards personal holiness comes as a result of the gospel. Let me put this in theological language, if I can do that for you. Just kind of, you know, synthesize, kind of thesaurus-type language. Justification is the act whereby God declares the sinner no longer a sinner, but instead righteous. Sinner, now a saint. That's justification. Sanctification, relating to justification, is whereby God, in cooperation with the sinner, who is now a saint, and the saint, in cooperation with God, kind of this Philippians 2 language, which we've already looked at before, verses 10, 11, 12, and 13, matures the Christian, while the Christian is himself maturing himself in this idea of becoming more like Christ. So justification, forgiven by the work of Christ, perfect in Christ, but now sanctification, working out that identity in the practice of your life. What we see here in verse 27 is your manner of life, how you live, should be lived in light of what you believe, where your faith has been placed in the gospel. You see that there in verse 27. Let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel. In other words, let them connect. Let them connect. Friends, rhetorically I ask you, because you already know the answer, what is one of the most common excuses given by non-Christians or accusations by non-Christians about Christians? It's our hypocrisy. It's our ungodliness. Now, just to be fair, all Christians are hypocrites. All Christians are sinners. It isn't as if once we became Christians, we're like, stop sinning. We would say within our Christian community, our problem is not whether or not we sin, it's whether or not we repent of that sin. But so often, and so sadly, what the world can perhaps rightly say about some of us, if not many of us, is that our lives do not look to be subscribing to what it is we said we believed in, Jesus, and therefore committed to obey all that his word taught. Our marriages, not too terribly different. Our children, not too terribly different. Our financial commitments and passions and idolatries, not too terribly different. Our views of personal morality and sexual identity, not too terribly different. Now, I don't mean to sort of judge any and all of us or any one of us, but I mean to say we need to take a hard look at what the passage is saying, which is if we profess to believe the gospel, which we do if we say we're Christians, we believe Jesus is the Savior, then we must practice that profession in our lives of holiness. And what continues to connect us back is the gospel. I was saved so that I no longer have to be a slave to my sin. And I would love to show that to my neighbors, to my family, and to my friends. I'd love to let them see that I am indeed different because of the gospel. It's not that I just sort of read a self-help book, became newly intelligent or had a sort of an intellectual epiphany, or I forgave all the people to whom I've been a victim of. No, instead, it's that the gospel has changed me, and it continues to change me as it motivates my life to be personally holy. Now, here's the key. Partnership in relationships is key for this to take place. In other words, let's put the passage in context. Let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel. Here's what he's not saying. He's not just saying, you, Sam, let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel. He's saying, let you, Castleview Baptist Church, let your life be worthy of the gospel. He's not just identifying one person to the neglect of all of the people. He is describing all people, both individually and collectively. What that means is he intends our community of Christians, our local church, to be identified together as a people whose lives collectively, as a community, are working itself out into greater Christ-likeness, greater personal and collective holiness. We cannot do that apart from each other. That requires relationships. I used to have a place in Florida, and a townhome, two-bedroom townhome, kind of high ceilings, and take all the money you can get just to get a place, and then you're like, the stuff's got to go in the place, right? And I had to get some ceiling fans, and I went to install my first ceiling fan. Has anybody installed a ceiling fan by themselves? Yeah. You know where this is going. It is misery. Right? The first thing, the cover ought to say is, don't do this alone. No, I know you think you're different. No, I'm talking to you. Don't do this alone. No. I'm still talking to you. I'm still talking to you. Yep, I know that you think you're good tools and that you're really stuck. Don't do this alone. I did it alone. And there I am, I'm on this ladder, I'm on this 6-foot ladder, higher than you're supposed to go on the steps, right? And there I am, kind of got my leg wrapped around it, I got this fan, I'm shouldering the thing, I'm trying to work on the wiring, get the wing nuts going, I'm trying to get everything, I'm thinking, I'm going to die. But I'm not sure I want my obituary to read, he died installing a ceiling fan, snapped his neck. I mean, this got to be a more dignified way to go, something I want to be Braveheart, he died fighting, for somebody who needed to be fought for. I don't want to die installing a ceiling fan. So thankfully, I had a little bit of sense. By the time I came to my second ceiling fan, I called my friend, can you come over and help me? I need you to hold this while I do this. What's like that in the Christian life? We're trying to sanctify ourselves. We're like juggling life on the 6-foot ladder, falling over, trying to install electrical circuitry in our life, thinking, I wonder why I'm not successful. I wonder why I want to give up. I wonder why I'm really exhausted. It's because you're doing this all alone. You were never intended to work that out alone. You were intended to do that inside a context of community, inside your local church, where people taught you and you taught people, where people prayed for you and you prayed for people. People encouraged you, and you encouraged people. People were patient with you and forgave you, and you were patient with people and forgave them. The gospel inside the community compels this personal holiness. The second way the gospel is the center of our Christian lives is that the gospel convinces others of Christian community. The gospel convinces others of Christian community. Go back to verse 27. This is what he wants them to be known for in light of the gospel. Not just their manner of life, but then he says here, that I may hear of you, that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel. The reality here is that there is something to be said about Christ by us, by how we relate to each other who profess to be followers of Christ. Saying it differently, we are making theological statements. We are making Christological statements, statements about the doctrine of Christ, by how we get along together, by how we interact with one another. It's exactly what he's talking about here, that I may hear that you are standing firm. There's a solidness to this, in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side. It's the language of partnership. It's the same kind of imagery that comes in later in chapter 2. You know what? I trust many of you, as we've worked through this already together. Let's review it again, though. It says in verse 2, complete my joy, being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. How do you get people to have one mind when we all have different opinions and preferences? Am I supposed to prefer your favorite color? Are you supposed to prefer my favorite music? Are you supposed to prefer favorite time? How do we work this out? Do we deny ourselves? Do we act like I'm not Eric and I'm not Sam and I'm not Sally and I'm not Mary? What are we supposed to do? How does this work? this oneness. It's because of what it says there, for the faith of the gospel. Our identity is not in our individuality, but in our unity in Christ. Again, as I continue to advocate for here at Castleview Baptist Church, we need to be a case study in sociological phenomenon. How did they get all these people to agree to gather together? When I know some of those people individually, they would not have done it like that. They would not have sat like that. They would not have dressed like that. They would not have gone like that. They would have listened like that. They would not have interacted like that. They would not have worn that. They would not have listened to that. They would have sung that. How did all that work? How did that happen? Because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because of the reality that we find our identity in Him and Him in us, with all of us. Let me give you some ways in which I think the gospel is a center for a Christian community. I think, first of all, as I said just a minute ago, it explains our identity together. It explains our identity. We need to give an answer for how we all got here. Secondly, I think it fuels our love for each other. If I've been greatly and amazingly and overwhelmingly loved, I'm more inclined to love somebody else. I mean, seriously, you want to catch me like at my best? Catch me like after a date night. I mean, I'm like Cupid. I'm just like shooting love arrows everywhere. I mean, to be loved by my wife is just, I just want everybody to experience that. I used to be a missionary for marriage in seminary. I'd find all the guys who weren't married like, dude, what's the deal? We got to help you out. Is it you can't communicate? You're not like a good leader? What's happening? Please tell me, like, something's going on here. What's going on? I was just a missionary. Why? Because I wanted to experience what I experienced. But that's what happens when you realize how much you as a sinner have been loved by God in Christ. You are just finding yourself greatly fueled in your love for one another. One practical question, if you're having trouble loving a brother or sister in Christ, so how do I love them more? I would say stop that conversation, go to a different conversation, and say go back to finding out how much you have been loved by God in spite of yourself, not because of yourself. And see how that can teach you how to love another person in spite of them, not because of them. Because let's be honest, not all of us, in fact, not any one of us is lovable all the time. But to love somebody when they're not lovely, oh, that's to begin to point to these gospel illusions of something greater happening there. It also becomes, the gospel also motivates us to practice forgiveness towards one another, which relates to our love. It also gives us a model on how to serve one another. You heard me even say it in our prayers. Mark 10, verse 45, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to offer his life as a ransom for many. It compels our generosity and financial giving. Now he's explaining where all the money came from. It's like, of course I'm generous. How would I not be generous? God is generous to me. He has lavished me. I mean, do you realize how much language in Ephesians and other places are talking about our inheritance has been lavished, just deposited greatly in abundance upon us? Generosity encourages generosity. Well, realize the generosity God has towards you. Ask yourself, why am I not generous towards others? For our non-Christian friends who are here, just two resources I might recommend you to read to kind of better understand the nature of the church, who we are, what it is, to kind of better connect with us, to at least sort of see what we're talking about here. One resource is called The Gospel-Centered Life, Becoming the Person God Wants You to Be, by Steve Timmis and Tim Chester, two guys from Britain. Just a helpful small resource, a little study. As a non-Christian, you might be interested to do that, or even yourself as you are a Christian listening to this. Gospel-centered church. So the gospel-centered life and gospel-centered church, two helpful resources that can be used to understand this idea of Christian community, the gospel, why they're so big on Jesus, why don't they sort of get over that? Why can't they go dig more wells and hurry up and break up from their meetings? This might help you help explain some of this. So the first way the gospel is the center of our Christian lives, it compels personal holiness. The second way it's the center of our Christian lives is it convinces others of our Christian community. It's our apologetic in many respects. And then the third way the gospel is a center of our Christian lives is it comforts us as Christians in life. It comforts us in life. I mean, I think what I see here in the text is encouraging to read verse 28. It says, and not frightened, Philippians chapter 1 here, and not frightened in anything by your opponents. This is a clear sign of them of their destruction, but of your salvation, and that from God. For it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ, you should not only believe in him, but also suffer for his sake. Engage in the same conflict that you saw I had and now hear that I still have. This is counterintuitive and honestly uncomfortable, but true. Christians suffer. And sometimes, in some places, at some times, they suffer more than non-Christians. And here we're telling people, hey, become a Christian. You got anything else to offer? I was hoping for something different. But what we see here in Philippians is a real candid look at life that's candid and yet encouraging and comforting. It's candid in this sense, you're going to have opponents as Christians. It's candid in this sense, you're going to suffer. Just because you become a Christian doesn't mean you don't get cancer. Many of you know that, having had or right now have cancer. Just because you're a Christian parent doesn't mean your kids will now be automatically good. Some of you know what that's like to have a runaway child, estranged adult children that even now you don't speak to. Just because you become a Christian doesn't mean you're going to have a perfect job and pay raises that you can't keep up with. So I mean, what it's like to be passed over for a raise because you wouldn't go along with sort of the unspoken policy in your office, how to sort of manage the deadlines and the paperwork so that things could look the way they're supposed to look, the betterment of upper management. No, that's not what the Scriptures are promising. What the Scriptures promise is in the midst of this fallen world, hope, comfort, community. That you are a part of a people who are a part of someone who indeed went through all the injustice that could be measured out, who experienced all the temptation that you have experienced and more, didn't give in to any of it, paid for all of it, that we might be forgiven, that others might be forgiven, and that there might be hope for a world to come by his ultimate return. What I find so interesting is how commonly the Scriptures refer to the gospel as not being for Christians to tell non-Christians, but for Christians to tell Christians. I mean, think about Romans chapter 1. Clearly writing to a Christian church, he speaks of their testimony, their reputation, how they are in Christ, loved by God's saints, Romans chapter 1, verse 17, or verse 7. But listen to what he says in verse 15. He says, I am eager to preach the gospel to who? To you also who are in Rome. He says it again later in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 to a different church. He's describing this reality. He says in chapter 15, verse 1, now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel that I preached to you, which you received and in which you stand, and by which you're being saved. Friends, to know that you have a Savior who is a sympathetic and high priest, Hebrews chapter 4, who comforts you in your afflictions, who gives you grace and the capacity for forgiveness towards injustice, who gives you hope for tomorrow when otherwise it feels like a dark valley of today. That is found in Christ, and that is found by reminding yourself of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So when we say we're disciples of Christ, we're saying we're followers of Jesus. That's what it is. To be a Christian is to be a disciple. To be a disciple is to be a Christian. To be a disciple is to be a learner, a follower of Christ. That's what he says in Matthew chapter 28. Make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teach them to observe all that I've commanded. Christians are disciples of Christ. But we need to make sure as disciples of Christ that we don't forget Christ in our discipleship. The good news of God for us, that we can find the capacity, the motivation to live out our lives as these people of God. When many Christians today think of the gospel, sadly, they go back in their memory to when they first heard it, understood it, believed it, and responded to it by repentance and faith. Because it's a historical time stamp on their Christian passport, only pulling out occasionally to tell people when's the date when they traveled to that country, to that belief, but in place, instead not a place that's to be occupied. But we see from Scripture the gospel is more than just an evangelistic conversation. It's a life conversation. It's the good news for sinners, of which every person in this room is one. Much like worship being falsely relegated to a Sunday service time slot, and even sadly within a small section of a Sunday service time slot, like music. And instead, rightly thinking of it as all of that worship and all of that life beyond just that worship service, so too can the gospel be wrongly limited and relegated to such a small part of the Christian conversation. My hope is for us as a church that we would be a people who are indeed centered, reminded, encouraged, built up in Christ and who He is and what He has done. That's the good news. That's the gospel. And that's what we've come to celebrate in the Lord's table. In a minute, I'm going to pray. Pastor Rick is going to come and help us think this out as we participate in the Lord's Supper, how to think this out in our lives as we take the Lord's Supper time as a time of reflection, what God would have for us. As I'm praying, if the men who are serving the Lord's Supper would come and have a seat up front, that would be appreciated. Let's pray. God, thank you for your mercy towards us in your Son. Thank you for the hope we have. Thank you for the joy that is ours. God, I pray for persons present, whom you've brought here. Maybe they thought they just came for some other reason, but God, you make no mistakes. Who do not trust in you, who do not have their identity in you, Father, let them turn and believe. May today be the day of their salvation, of their rescue. And Father, for the rest of us who are your children, adopted by your grace because of your mercy, now indeed sons of God, we pray, Father, that you would remind us to not forget our identity, to not put away our hope, but to indeed find our hope in you and the work that you've done for us, Jesus, and all that you've accomplished, that we fail to realize how powerful, how sufficient your life, death, resurrection, ascension, current reign is for us today. Help us to see this. Amen.
A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. The words from Jesus, from Christ. What does our love for one another do? What does it look like? It displays God's glory. As we think about his grace that has transformed our lives, changed our lives, and then causes us to willingly lay down our lives for others. So what does that specifically look like? Not in generalities, but specifically as we flesh that out. Members, people that are committed to one another at Castleview Baptist Church. What do others see about God when they look at us, when they look at our relationships? We need to be committed to one another. And so just some things to remind you of, for you to think about, ways that you can be intentional and specific this week. But we display God's glory in our life together when we commit to love one another, bear one another's burdens, submit to one another, encourage and instruct one another, preserve the unity of the faith together. These aren't just phrases on a screen that sound pleasant, but should be a living reality of us here at Castleview Baptist Church. So this week, how are you going to pursue someone else by loving them specifically, not in generalities? How are you, who is the Holy Spirit bringing to your mind to bear their burden? That you need to step into the mess of their lives, help them suffer well. Who are you going to take God's word to this week and encourage them? Speak truth to them. And how are you going to preserve the unity of faith together? Right? That we're not being critical of one another, but we're interceding for one another. We're being Christ's ambassador to each other. And we're not going to have a program where we do all of this, but as we cultivate a culture, an environment of the one another's, of love, we're unleashing you to do this. Go do this. There's not going to be a program that kind of puts all of this together, but just go in your relationships with one another. What steps will you take this week to make those things on that screen a living reality? In this room, there may be relationships that are fractured. You need to go. You need to ask forgiveness. You need to remind yourself of the gospel that you have been loved. Therefore, I'm loving you. I want to be reconciled in this relationship. What will you do this week to partner with someone else in the gospel? And it is so closely connected to what we're about to partake in the Lord's Supper. And Paul talks about this in 1